Well, hello everyone, it's Kevin here. Today, I want to talk about hot cues and music mixing. Now, I know that some DJs obviously have perfected the craft of beat matching or beat mixing and blending songs together so that there's a seamless transition from one song to the next. Now, this video might not be for you if you're a pro at beat mixing. Now, you might be a DJ who is pretty good at beat mixing. Maybe you use BeatSync, the sync feature that is available on most controllers, like I have in front of me. Here I have the DDJ 1000 from Pioneer. You might be that kind of DJ, or maybe you use hot cues like I use, and those kind of help you with your beat mixing. I'm going to show you guys my tips and tricks and workflow on how to do that kind of beat matching and mixing. Now, there could be a third type of you guys out there that never beat mix and you don't match the beat for song A to song B. And maybe you use the crossfader and just move from track one to two, or maybe you just kind of drop the song at the end of the next song. One song ends and the other song begins and you just drop it like a radio or something. That's perfectly fine. However, you have found success in playing music for people is fine. But I think that if you learn at least a little bit about how to beat match and how to do mixing, I think it'll take your DJing to the next level and you'll have a lot of fun doing it too. Okay guys, so I'm gonna change the camera angle and jump in and show you guys a couple things here. All right guys, so hopefully you can see okay here. I'm gonna go ahead and share the screen so you guys can see my Rekordbox DJ software. And when I look at, I created a little list here of just a couple songs that we can go through. And I'm not gonna play the whole song just because, you know, it's copyright and everything, but I'll play enough of it so you guys get a sense of what we're doing here. And first up, I wanna just bring in a song that basically I'm gonna use first. I'm gonna use this Carlton song, She's a Bad Mama Jamma, which is such a great tune if you don't know it. But this is a song, this is like as easy as it gets to set up my cue points for mixing. So essentially, if you don't know this song, here's just a little sample of it. So hopefully you guys recognize that. And what I'm gonna do is, what I do when I bring in a new song into my library, I, of course, as I've shown on other videos, I might rename the track. I might put a little comment in square brackets. So in this case, it's an in, which means it's a DJ intro edit. So it's got some beats up front that I can work with to help me mix. Usually the intro edits I get from music pools like DMS or whatnot will also have an outro to it. So this one does as well. And you can kind of tell in the waveform, you can see the intro over here on the left, and then on the right, you can see the outro. So She's a Bad Mama Jamma has both intro and outro edits. Of course, I also will set the year and make sure everything's good on my information. I set a rating and a color code, which is just my energy level for this track. Anyway, back to it. Let's set up these hot cues, okay? And my whole goal with setting hot cues is to make sure that I'm ready to go with points in the song that I know I can mix into and out of any track in my library. And it's really important to me that I have those references. Now, when I'm actually at an event, I might use my headphones and I might do some different things, some different tricks. I might mix in at a different point in the song. But what I want to do is have that baseline expectation of all my music in my library that I'm ready to go with the right hot cues in the right spot. So let me show you what I'm talking about. We're going to go ahead and do this with She's a Bad Mama Jamma. So first up, I kind of scrub through the song here and I can kind of see that the Rekordbox software did a pretty good job on this song at basically identifying and picking out the beat. It's very typical of a song that's been produced with a DJ intro edit for there to be a consistent beat, okay? And if you look at this, I can almost tell, I can already tell that this is good. This has detected a beat, and in record boxes, blue is bass and orange is like mid-range, and the cream white is high frequencies. So I can see that this is bass drum and probably snare or hi-hat, and then another, you know, and there's a bass kind of component to every beat. So let's just listen to what this sounds like, this intro edit. So you kind of get the drift of what this is doing. Now, what I want to do here is show you guys that Rekordbox is counting bars for me. And of course, it's also by counting bars, it's also counting beats as a decimal. And then of course, as you move through the song, you can kind of read what Rekordbox thinks is what bar and what beat you're on. So what does that mean? Well, we start off right here on bar 1.1. That means beat one, okay? Beat one of bar one. Beats are any kind of, it's like the rhythm of the song, okay? It's the pulse of the music. And the bar is a collection of four of those, okay? So if I go just one bar, you're gonna see this count up from 1.1 to 1.2 to 1.3 to 1.4. Right? You saw that. So 1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4. And we start over in the next bar, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, 2.4, and so on. So that's basically how any kind of 4-4 time signature songs are used and counted here in our Rekordbox software. And it's pretty standard across any software. And in fact, if you didn't have any software and you're just using records, you'd want to think in that way too. You might have heard that term, drop it on the one. Well, basically what you're trying to say is, you're trying to let people know, and that's a good little rule of thumb, that you want to drop a track. If you're bringing another song in, you want to drop it on the one. So what does that mean? That means you would drop it now, or now, because that's the one, the first beat of the bar. Okay. Now, typically, songs these days, you know, the structure of songs have, you know, they're thought of in 4-bar blocks, or sometimes 8, or sometimes 16 or 32. And if you're familiar with dance music, you're very familiar with this kind of configuration. But most songs, even, you know, from 70s, 80s on, you're going to have this structure, and certainly even back before then, you're going to have this structure in the 4-4 time signature of 4 is your bass, 4 bars. So what we have here with Bad Mama Jamma is you've got 2 sets of 4 bars, so basically 8 bars. Now, as I start here, right, I got 1, 2 bar, 3rd bar, 4th bar, then we get into the 5th bar, etc. And we actually move all the way to, like I said, 8 bars. And then we get into, this is like where the vocals start. This is like the if you were to hear the song on the radio, this is where the actual beginning of the song, for me in any way, you know, the way I think about it, it's like the beginning of the song where the vocals come in. So check this out. I'm just gonna play this last bar, the 8th bar, and you'll hear it because the vocals are gonna come in on the 9th bar. Ready? Here we go. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. And that is key for me for how I set my hot cues. So here's what I do. I find that spot where the vocals kick in. In this song, it's really easy because it's a DJ intro edit. Most DJ intro edits are either 8 bars or 16 bars. This one happens to be 8 bars. And, or the way I think about it, 2 sets of 4 bars. Here's why that's important. For me, I think about everything in 4-bar chunks. So for this, I find that spot. Once I'm happy with the way that the software picked where the beats are, like, you know, these little lines, these segmentations line up with the actual beat of the music. Doesn't always happen. Sometimes you have to make adjustments, and I think I have an example here we'll show you. But sounds good, I like it, and I'm gonna set my first hot cue right there. Now, I use hot cue B, and here's why. I want hot cue B to be on the first bar where music turns into like the real song, or where vocals come in. I want B to be where the vocals are coming in. So when I hit B, when I hit my hot cue B, right? Right there. That's the beginning of the song for me. That's where it gets interesting, you know, with the vocals coming in. It could be a chorus, could be a verse. It depends on the song structure or the remix or the redrum or whatever I'm using. But that's really important for me to have hot cue B, or the second hot cue in my little setup here, as my, and you can see a visual representation here on the screen. Here's hot cue B for me. So it's right at that moment where the ninth bar begins and the vocals start. Okay, so what am I gonna do here next is I'm gonna go back 1, 2, 3, 4 bars, okay? Now I kinda just looked at the counter here, 5.1, because I know, you know, 4 from 9 is 5, but what I wanna do is I wanna set my first hot cue A, or this one here, my first hot cue, to that moment where I'm 4 bars back from the lyrics kicking in. So basically, here's what this sounds like now. Okay. Okay, and I turned that down a little bit, so I'll raise it up a little bit so you guys can hear. But essentially, we got these 4 bars, and then we drop it in. Boom. Okay. Now, what that does for me is it allows me to visually know on any song in my library, if I hit this first hot cue, okay, I've got 4 bars till we go live with vocals. And that has been extremely, extremely helpful. And in cases where I need a little more, let's say I need to mix in a little longer of a segment, and I need an extra 4 bars. You know, in this song, it has 8 bars, right? That we just explored. And you can even see it on the screen. If you look at the waveform here, you can see that there's so much space before this A hot cue here, okay? You can tell that there's more. So if I need that, it's super easy for me to, you know, with my fader, volume fader down, so the audience doesn't hear, I can pop over to A, okay, my hot cue A, and I can wheel back 4 bars, okay? There's a couple easier ways to do that. I can do it on the, you know, I can do it with my mouse here, okay, on the laptop. I can also, a super helpful tool on the DDJ 1000, and I'm sure other controllers, I know this exists on other controllers, is beat jump. So I click the beat jump buttons, and you can kind of see a representation here on the screen. And this is how many beats you want to jump. So I can use 4 beats forward, okay, or 4 beats back. Okay, boom. So if I need a little extra space, a little more runway for my mixing, boom, I can do that quick. But I know every song in my library is coded the same way, okay? Now, is there anything magic about the colors? Not for me, there isn't. I just use the default standard color coding. So whatever record box decided as red is going to be for A and blue is going to be for B. I don't really care about the colors as much. I just care that number 1 and number 2 are set in those positions. Very important for me. So now that we've got this set up, I know that I could have another song at, you know, 114 BPM on the other, jog wheel, my other track, coming in at 114, and I could be playing that song, and I know I can mix this in super simple right here by hitting that hot cue right on the one of my track that's on side B or side 2. And then I just have to mix out before the lyrics start. And you know what? What this gives me is a lot of versatility. Let's say that I've got a an intro on track B on my other deck, and it's got a longer intro than I thought, or maybe I've never set up my hot cues before. So what I could do is, check this out, I can be playing this, and look, I'm on bar 6, bar 7, bar 8, I can go back to bar 5. Look at that, I could do that all day long. And you know, as long as I'm doing it on time, you would never know any different, okay? So if you need a little extra time, I know that I can go back to that safe spot. Just like that. Now sometimes, now this is a truism for most, for many, many songs, the vocals might start a little bit before, like in this case, the vocals start a little bit after my ninth bar, right? So like, listen, I'm gonna hit my second hot cue and you'll hear the, like the vocals start like one beat in. Right? Well, and that's cool. Sometimes though, it starts before. So my vocals might start like back here on 8.2 or 8.3. So there's like a little bit of a, you know, I'm singing and then I catch up to the beat, like a preamble or something like that. That's fine. You just have to be a little more careful. If you're gonna do the trick that I just did where you're playing your four bars and then you hit your first hot cue again and jump back, you just have to be a little careful because you don't wanna catch that little phrase. So if you're gonna do that, you might just have to live with it, or you can always just snap back at like bar 7 or something. You know, like here's the 5th bar, here's the 6th bar, and then on 7, just switch back. Okay. Any case, that's just a little pro tip. Also notice this, I'll show you guys this. I've got this little cue. This is the quantize feature. And this basically says that when I'm setting hot cues and such, like I can have the needle here or here, and it's still gonna set the hot cue at the closest segment of line. So look at this, I'm way over here and I'm gonna hit A. And look, it set the hot cue over here, okay? Even though my line wasn't directly on the one. Now, if I turn off quantize and I hit that, I'm gonna take off the cue by holding shift and hitting the A hot cue. I'm gonna do that again, watch what happens. It puts it right there, and that's bad because that's not on beat. I don't know if you can tell, but there's like a preamble there, a preliminary sound. We don't want that, so I like to keep quantize on when I'm doing these hot cue setups. Sometimes you have to turn hot cue or quantize off to set your hot cues in peculiar spaces, and we'll talk about that, but let me put that hot cue right back. All right, guys, we've got the start of the song, the start of the vocals of the track, got that marked on hot cue letter B, the blue one, and I've got the 4 bars back from that where we got some beat, so that gives me my little runway to mix into the song from another track, okay? So that's set up. Now I got to think about the back end of the track. So this one also is just really easy. So I'm gonna jump forward, and you can even see visually where the song kind of drops off. And what happens is the song finishes, the classic, you know, version of the song finishes, and then it goes into that DJ outro edit. So just listen to how that sounds. Okay, that or whatever, that was like the end of the track, and then it gets into that, just, you know, this is just like the outro edit. This is here for us as a tool in this edit version of the song to mix in the next song, okay? So what I do is I find the end of the track proper, okay? Because I don't really like to spend a lot of that outro track mixing out. Sometimes I use it because, especially if I'm playing around with different genres, but if you are like most people, and I've come to appreciate this as a DJ, most people don't want to hear a bunch of like preliminary sounds. They want to get right to the song. They want to get right to the parts they know, and they want to sing along and dance along. And crowds can kind of be fickle sometimes. So you want to get to the music that they want to hear and that they love. So what I do is I find the last moment of the song. So in this case, it's going to be real close to here. It's going to be right there. That's the last part of the structure of the song, the last part of the main phrase, if you will. Okay, and I'm going to mark that with my my eighth hot cue, which is H, letter H here. Okay, that's the end. That's the far as I want to go in a track. Now, the wahoo, that kind of, it kind of does go past that mark just a little bit. Listen, it goes beyond that just a little bit. Right? It goes, this is at bar 101, beat one. It goes to about beat two, okay? That's okay. I want to get out of that song. I'm going to get out of this track right at H. And what that means is I need to have some point, some hot cue marked four bars back from this moment in the song, okay? And again, I could simply use the beat jump, I could use my mouse, or I can just kind of roll back one, two, three, four bars, okay? And I set G, okay, which is the seventh hop cue. Now, what does that do? That gives me four bars of runway to get out of a track. And it's interesting parts of the song. It's not just that outro edit that is kind of bland and boring. So I don't use the outro edit typically. Sometimes I do. And if I need to, it's there. It's kind of like a built-in buffer, like something to help me if I need the help, right? So you can see it in the visual. You can see past H. I've got basically eight bars of outro edit that I can play with if I need to or whatever. But here's how this sounds when I hit the G hot cue, which is, again, four bars back from the end of the vocal part. That's really the end of the song for, as far as I'm concerned, and where I want to get out into the next track by. Okay, here we go. Okay, and then it's just that outro part. Man, this is such a jam, isn't it? Any case, so what we have here now is the song is set up the way I like it. Now, I have all these other hop cues, right? I've got, you can see on the screen, I've got C, D, E, and F, and I can play with these and do different things with them. What usually I do is I put a quick mix spot in the song, like somewhere in the middle, I'll use D for, and that'd be similar to my G trigger, okay, my G hot cue. That'd be a trigger for me. It's not necessarily where I'm gonna push G or push H. These are triggers for me, okay? Hopefully that makes sense. Sometimes I might need to fast forward to a song, or I might need to go back to a hot cue where I'm marking four bars back, or I'm marking the end of the audio, or the you know, the phrase, the last phrase of the track. Sometimes I might need to jump back to that. But what I'm trying to do here is give myself visual cues. So really, the A hot cue is my main button that I'm going to be hitting and launching the track. B is a visual cue most of the time with the start of the audio or the vocals. G is my visual cue for, hey, I've got to be start mixing in and blending in the next song because in four bars I'm dropping out. And then H is my visual cue to be out of the song by. So hopefully that makes sense. And you'll see as I do some examples. But I use these other hot cues for, like I said, D would be maybe something in the middle here right after a chorus where I want to get out of the song, like in a quick mix scenario. Quick mixing, you know, you play maybe a minute of a song or something. So right, maybe here in the middle, I would put one of those on beat and everything and make sure that it comes out at the right spot. But that would be an example. And I might use some of these other hot cues for whatever. You can name hot cues in your software too, but if you have a standard system like I'm using here, you know, you don't need to because you know you know what every song's hot cues actually mean. And if you use some of these middle ones, C, D, E, F, for something different, you might choose to name them. Okay, all right. So I now have She's a Bad Mama Jamma ready to go in my system. Now, next I wanted to go into do a song that does not have a DJ intro edit. So that is Jungle Love by Morris Day and the Time. So this is another great song. You probably know of it. Yeah. Great jam. Okay, what we're gonna do with this one is, what I do with every song, okay, I go through and every time I get a track in my library, I make sure that the name's good and I've got the right year and all this, and I set my color code and my rating, color code for energy. Now, I'm gonna go in here and I'm gonna just check out, the software did its best to try to identify the beat of the song. This is a song from the 80s. It's a song with a real band. It's not a computer generated, drum machine or something. So it's gonna likely have some errors or some issues with the way that it identified the beat. So let's just take a look at this and just I'll play the front part. Notice that this is not a DJ intro edit. This is just a song that I bought off iTunes, I believe. This has no. This has no additional production on it. This isn't an edit or a remix. This is just a normal radio play version of the song. So definitely, as I was eyeballing this here, you can see. Okay, already I can see that it's not perfectly aligned with the beat pattern. Okay, that's okay. That happens, especially, as I said, with older songs that were recorded live. And also, I'm gonna flip through here, and what I'm doing is I'm watching the beat per minute here, the beats per minute. And it looks consistent. So that means that one of two things, either Moore's Day and the time were so on time that they did a perfectly BPM, sound and song, and the computer picked it up perfectly, which both scenarios are unlikely. When you're playing live music with live percussion, you don't have a consistent BPM throughout. Also, the software to pick it out, it would have looked a lot better at the beginning. We already saw that it didn't look so good. So what I do is I say, okay, my first thing is I'm gonna see what will do better here. If I really have two strategies with older songs, and I have to figure out which will work better. Okay, number one is, take the fixed BPM pattern. In this case, it's a 119.77 beats per minute pattern that the software detected. And I'm gonna try to see if I can just align it and see if it works, okay? I can hear the first beat of the song, right? You can hear it right here. It's right there. Did you hear it? It's right there. Okay. So I can hear that's the first beat of the song. And I'm gonna see if I can just align it and using that standard beat, see if we're close enough. Sometimes you're close enough and the computer did a good job. It just maybe not, it didn't have the right alignment, but it did a good job at detecting sort of the pace or the metronome of the song. Okay, so the way you do this in Rekordbox is I have my needle set. I'm gonna unload She's a Bad Bam Jamma, so it's not confusing. Okay, so you can see right here is where that first beat is. We kind of detected it. And, there's probably some more science behind this, because if you look at this, the wave pattern, you can see there's a little bit of yellow first, a little cream color, which is like the high frequencies, and then the bass kicks in like a millisecond after. You can see that crack there in the pattern. You might want to start on the bass, but I'm going to go ahead and just put it right there. You might want to start on the bass. That's really what people feel as the beat of the song. So I'm gonna put it right kind of near the start, right there. Okay, so now that we have this, what I can do is in Rekordbox, there's this little editor here. Right now I'm in the normal edit mode, which shows me hot cues. I can click this little editor here, and this is for the grid editing. So I'm editing this grid pattern, and I can do a couple things. I can actually move the whole grid. Watch this, see, look, I'm moving the whole grid around, okay? And I can do that and make micro adjustments. I can make the grid wider or more condensed, and that basically changes the BPM that the software overlays on top. It doesn't change the sound of the song at all. The song is the song, but what this can do is fine tune that grid detection. So this is pretty advanced. Like, you know, if you are first getting into it, maybe try not to, you know, get too overwhelmed, because there's a lot of things you could do here. You can even do segments of songs where BPM changes throughout the song. You can change it. I care most about the beginning and the end, because that's where when I'm mixing. Unless, of course, I want to do a quick mix setup, in which case I'm in the middle as well. But for these purposes, let's just focus on the beginning and the end, all right? So the beginning, I've got my marker, my needle marker, which is this red line here, right at the moment of the beginning of the song. And instead of, like, I can move these little lines over and get, I could get the start of a bar, which is the red, these red markers. I could get that to a line there, or I can just click this button right here. This just, it says right there, sets the first beat of a bar to the current position. Boom. So now I've got this set up in the proper way. And how can I tell? Well, I can just play it. Right? Okay, cool. Okay, so I know that's the first beat of the song. Now I want to see, how did that work? Okay, how did I do? Do I have a line grid now to the beat of the song? So check this out. There's one. Okay, and let's see if the next bar has the grid aligned. Sounds like it to me. Okay, let's go two bars in. Let's see. Sounding really good. Let's do it one more time and let's go all four bars, okay? That looks good, guys. That looks really good. So I'm happy with the grid placement so far. Now, let's keep going just a little bit longer. Okay, guys, I'm really happy with that. You might say, well, look, Kevin, it's, do you see this part? It's like, it's not exactly on the line. Here's, it's a little early here, but we kind of catch up when we get into the vocals right here. Listen, right? It catches up and it's consistent enough. And that's what I'm looking for. I'm not looking for perfection. You could kill yourself trying to make a grid match a song, and don't, one of my friends always says, don't let perfect be the enemy of great. So it doesn't need to be perfect. It needs to be great. It needs to be, enough that you can play with. All right. So during this little check of the grid, I've actually identified the first part of the song where the vocals come in, and it's bar 11 right here, beat one. All right. So I'm going to do what I do. Here, I'm going to go back to hot cue mode. Okay, and I'm gonna set that B hot cue. And by the way, you can click it on the computer here as well. You don't have to use your controller, but it's fun to do the controller. Now that I'm here, what do? I go four back from that point in the song because I want four bars to help me mix in. So let's go ahead and go back. One, two, three, four. All right, set that hot cue. All right, now check it out. Perfect, or great, let's call it. Okay, that's what I want. And I got this song ready to go. Now, there could be some parts up in here that I'm missing. Like, check this out. Just as an example, this is the very beginning of the track itself. And this isn't a DJ edit, so this, again, it's just a radio play version. So if you heard this on the radio, you'd hear this little beginning part. That part's pretty cool, but think about the value it has to keeping your dance floor popping or keeping things exciting for your guests. It has very little value. It's quintessential, Morris Day and the Time. It's like part of the fabric of the song. And if you were listening to the song at home, I would say you would want to have the whole track and you'd want to hear that part. But on the dance floor, people don't care as much about those little tiny little accoutrements. So what I would say is, don't worry about it. If you have stuff in the intro, dump it. Don't worry about it, especially if it doesn't have a nice vibe or a beat to it, because people want to continue to move and they want a blend on the dance floor. They don't want to be jarred to a stop and hear some monkey call or whatever that ooh ah thing is from the jungle, and then go into the dancing again. They want to have that continuous movement from the last track to the next track. So, just my opinion. Don't worry about that stuff up front. So, in other words, for me, this song starts right here. All right, and we don't have that beginning part. We just have this part, and then after four bars, here we go. Right? Okay, now we need the back end of the song because we need to mix out of it too. So let's go ahead and jump to the back. And again, there's no DJ intro edit here, so I don't have any kind of tips or helper to show me exactly where I should jump out of the song. So sometimes this is just listening to where a natural endpoint would be for the song. I don't necessarily want like the back end of the track. Sometimes I do, but if there's like a big solo at the end or a big outro with a bunch of cymbals and a bunch of music and a crescendo, I don't need all that. You kind of want to maybe get out at the end of a second or third chorus or something like that, where it's just more consistent. You don't need, again, just like the front end of the song, you don't need all the fireworks, okay? So let's just hear it and let's see where. Okay, so this is the end of like the third or second chorus, maybe. Okay, I found my spot. I don't know if you guys could tell, but already I heard some of that outro fireworks stuff that I don't need. I don't need for this. So here's what I'm talking about. This part. You don't need all that. I know he said that's it, but that's not it. That's not it for us. Okay, so it looks like there's a natural. I think that's our spot. Let me just, this is kind of a process. So I'm gonna back up a few bars and I'm just gonna like listen and just see if it sounds right. All right, here we go. This is kind of like the verse, or the chorus rather. Okay, let's see what's coming up here, this part. Okay, here comes fourth bar, fifth bar of the chorus, sixth, seventh, eighth. I'm gonna do it right there, guys. That, basically what that just did, that gave me, that will give me enough bars, basically eight bars of a chorus, of a second or third chorus in here. And I think that's enough. I think that's enough to give the folks, a taste of the song. They get to sing along, they get the feeling for it, and we're gonna be mixing out of it. And I don't really want any of that outro stuff for my outro. I want, for my mix out, I want it to be consistent and recognizable. So I'm gonna choose that as my endpoint. Okay. So we're gonna go back four. One, two, three, four. And hear how this sounds. That's perfect. Now, the song keeps going. Of course it does. It keeps going and it's got another, you can kind of see here, it's got another probably, if this is four bars, it's got another four, another eight, another 12 bars probably, but it's not, I don't need all that, okay? I'm gonna be fine with what I got here. One thing I'd say is that if I was being very meticulous, I would say, hey, you know what? These aren't lining up just perfectly. I would like to see these, the grid back a little bit. And without changing the grid of the upfront part of the song, I can change just the part of the grid from this part forward. So I'm just gonna make a micro adjustment here. I'm gonna move the needle head to right about here. Okay, And I'm going to come down here. And instead of clicking this guy, which would reset the whole song, I'm going to click this guy, which makes an adjustment from the current position. If I click this, Rekordbox knows, oh, he's wanting to make a small micro adjustment. So I'm going to go ahead and move. You see where my G is and my red little line on the grid? It's going to snap that over to where my needle position is. So watch this. Boom. Okay. Now, it didn't move the hot cue, so I need to reset the hot cue. G. Okay, boom. Now that's on it. And everything forward will now be adjusted. And you can kind of see this, even this next bar, it's right between sort of where the snare comes in, and, or the hi-hat maybe, and the bass. So that's where I kind of wanted it. So let's go back and we'll go ahead and I'm gonna take off the last hot cue, H, and I set this right on the end. Perfect, that's where I wanted it. All right, guys, Jungle Love by Morris Day is now officially set up in my little system. Okay, next, I wanna show you guys, this is just another plain vanilla song, okay? This one will, basically, this is an EDM remix. So I wanted to show you guys an EDM remix because it's gonna have elements of a DJ intro edit. It's gonna have bars of intro material, but it's EDM, so it's gonna have longer phrases. I still use the four bar method. I still use that trick because what I wanna do is I wanna bring in, when I come into an event, I wanna know everything's set up in the same way for me. And I know that I can rock it, I can jam a party. And if I need to, get a little more runway for my songs, I can just use my headphones or I can use my beat jumper or whatever, and I can step back or I can step forward, get a little more runway, especially with EDM music. But I wanna stick to the four bar method, okay? And let's look at Kesha, Die Young, this EDM remix, and this is how this is gonna work. Now this starts off, okay, with a pretty dope little, a pretty dope little beat there. Now, did you notice that basically 4-4, the four bar kind of setup is so pronounced in EDM that they'll give you four bars and then they'll do something and give you another four bars and do something, typically change phrase every 8 bars or sometimes 16 bars. You can see that in the pattern right here. You can see, I'll push play here. This first four bars, okay, here we are, 3, and then fourth bar. Okay, and then we got this snare drum that kind of kicked in after the fourth bar. And notice you can even see it in the image on the preview waveform right here. You can see where the fourth bar ends and we have a little, extra little sound. The orange got a little bit bigger. That's that snare drum coming in. And then we have some more sound coming in after the 8th bar is finished, okay? So let's hear what that sounds like. All right. So the 8th bar is where Kesha starts singing. All right, in this remix. So notice it's that scenario I talked about earlier where she sings a little bit before the bar starts. So before the 9th bar, beat 1 of the 9th bar starts, you'll hear her voice. So watch this. So she starts singing at like right here, 8.25 or something. But here, this is the first beat. And I've been watching the grid and it's aligned really well. The software did a great job. And typical of EDM music or newer electronically produced music, the software does a great job finding it. Sometimes it might be off like a half a bar, off 2 beats. And you might have to just shift it, but usually it's really good with newer music. So I think this is my vocal drop point for my hot cue, okay? Even though if I were to hit this hot cue, listen, it cuts off her voice, right? You don't hear, I feel my, you just hear heartbeat, like it's in the middle. And that's, again, that's because the lead up to her vocals occurs right before the one. That's okay. I'm not using this hot cue to play. I'm using it as a visual marker to let me know when I need to be out of the song. Or, I'm sorry, when I need to be out of the other song. Because typically, I'm going to be dropping this song in on the outro of another song, and I've got a small runway before the vocals start, and I got to be out of the other song on the other track, on the other deck, okay? So, let's go, like, our process. We're going to back four. And in this case, you can see it in the preview waveform, so it's not too hard. And I set that, and boom. Now I got my three, four. Boom. Right? Nice and easy. No problems there. And I'm happy with the grid spacing and everything. So this song, we're going to go ahead and set the outro on it. As I go forward, I see that there's a lot of repetition, as is with a lot of EDM, of course, right? We like that because we're dancing to the beat. And you can see a lot of repetition, a lot of four-bar patterns. And just eyeballing it, you can see if the distance between A and B is one, you know, set of four bars, you can see I've got a four-bar set here, 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 here. And this looks like it mimics the intro, which is very typical of these EDM intro edits, and they'll have an outro that matches the intro. Okay, so I'm probably not going to want to play all these just like before. I don't want to play all the outro type content, but I probably want to capture this. This is probably chorus material, or it's got that rhythm that I want. So let's just hear it for a second. Oh yeah, that jams. Okay, now we're into that like outro kind of music. You know, not anything to write home about. And I don't really want, if I'm doing a party where it's an EDM dance party and that's all it is, I'm gonna definitely use the outros, and I'm gonna use the full 16 bar intro or 8 bar intro like this song. And I'm gonna blend over time more, because people want a smooth blend at an EDM party, right? You don't want that quick cutover. But at a wedding, at a house party, if it's not like EDM, it's open format, or like a bar, I want to get into the next song quick, because that's what people want. They want the parts that they know. And that probably means I probably wouldn't be playing a lot of EDM. But I just wanted to show you guys an example. So I'm going to pick up right before this outro kicks in for my last moment in the song proper, where I need to get out of the song. That's my marker. So as I look at, I think it's right here based on the visuals. I think it's right there. And from what I heard, so I'm going to set that. And then I'm going to go back for him and use beat jump, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then switch over, set that hot cue, and boom, here's the end. Four. Boom. And I'd be out of the song right now. All right. So again, I wouldn't use probably a four bar transition for EDM music. It would be a little longer, but it helps me here, right? To set up those markers and those cue points that I know, and it's consistent throughout my whole library. So we just did Die Young. I'll make one other comment that sometimes EDM, it's rare, but sometimes you'll find tracks that have different BPMs on purpose, okay? And sometimes you could have a BPM like 128 drop to something more slow and kind of like groovy, like, you know, 112 or 115, and then you pop back up to 128 to get the dancing going again. I would say that that's kind of like what I focus on is the beginning and the end of the song and the BPMs there, so I can mix better. As you learn your music more and as you get into it, and you might want to put different cue points in or whatever, maybe, you know, work on that, kind of figure out what tracks you have that have those BPM fluctuations on purpose. We already talked about older music will always have BPM fluctuations, and sometimes they're small. But think of a song like Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. I mean, that's going to have all kinds of little BPM changes, right? Because it's changing different styles. It's more like a rock opera, okay? It's going to have different styles, and it's going to bring about different BPMs. So I wouldn't worry so much about all the different BPMs and trying to get my grid perfectly on beat. That's going to kill you, okay? Just get it right to where keep it to the utility of I need to mix in and out of a song. Where am I going to do that? Probably at the beginning and the end. That's a good place to start. Okay, now I've got Die Young all set up and ready to go, and one more track. And this one brings up another unique scenario. So this is Celebrate by Pitbull, and you probably would know it from the... Okay, maybe you know that track. Now, with this one, it doesn't have an intro, so it's not an intro edit from a DJ pool or music pool or anything. It's also, it doesn't have like a natural beginning to it where, you know, kind of like we heard in Jungle Love, where it just had a natural beginning to it and it was easy to set up our little cue points, okay? It's got a little different setup here. So let me go ahead and show you guys. Let's just play the beginning of it so you can hear it. Okay. A lot of high energy in this song. I love it. It's so good. Anyway, so when you think about this song, you might say, well, here's this moment, which is bar 5, beat 1. This is kind of where it kicks in, and Pitbull's really starting to sing, okay? And it's like the first chorus, really. He comes right in with the chorus. All right. So definitely that's like where it's hype. So I would say... that's also where the vocals kind of kick in. So I set that as my B. And by the way, I should have addressed this first. I spot checked as we clicked go and play, and the grid looked really good. So that's always your first step. Make sure the grid's good, because otherwise it just won't make sense when you're setting these cue points. Sometimes I'll get into setting them and I'll be like, ooh, that's off. So I have to circle back and do it, which is fine. Okay, so I like this. I like that part. That sounds perfect, okay? So, now here's my where this song gets weird. I'm gonna go back 4, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, we're at the very beginning of the sound file. The song is at the very beginning. If I set my cue point there, and let's just listen to this, okay? This is how it would sound if I started here at... this is bar 1, beat 1. Miss Worldwide, let's celebrate. Yeah. Okay. Do you notice anything about that? It sounds really good. It's on beat. And if you watch the grid, it's hitting all the bass. You know, it's really got a good overlay. But there are vocals in it. There are vocals in it. So what do you do here, right? I don't want... to be mixing out of a track like Jungle Love and there's singing going on, right? Like, you know, Jungle Love, and there's like singing going on, and then I don't want Pitbull singing on top of Moore's Day. That's not good. We don't want vocals on vocals. That's bad as when, you know, that's a rule number one of taking of tracks and trying to mix them. You don't want the vocals to clash. So as I'm listening to that, I'm like, oh, that's... Pitbull. If you didn't say all that, I could get by with the 1, 2, 3, 4. Did you hear that in the background? The little 1, 2. That. I could get by with that. And I'm totally fine with a little bit of preliminary vocals like Kesha did in the prior track. But I can't deal with, like, you know, full volume vocals. That's going to be bad in mixing. So I got to come up with a better solution here. And here's my solution. This is, there's actually lots of ways you could solve this problem. One easy way to solve the problem would be to go find yourself a Celebrate DJ intro edit, okay? And, you know, I could show you right now, we could get on DMS and we could look and see if there's one. Okay, that's cool. If I'm playing that song a lot, maybe I go and I buy that and I invest in that, or I, you know, with most DJ pools, you have a set number of downloads you can have per month. and, you know, depending on the tier package you subscribe to, and you can download it. Great. You got that problem solved. You won't need to worry about his vocals. Another thing you could do, if you're real savvy, you could use like audio software like Audacity to take the vocals right out. You can remove vocals, whitewash them out of the track. If you own the music, you can do that, right? And take that right out of the file. You could also load up a, there are several DJ software packages like like Ableton or whatever, lots of production software that you could take. Even Rekordbox has an edit mode where you could create your own DJ edit by making the drum pattern in the song repeat before the music kicks in. So you could create your own drum edit. Those are some easy and maybe not so easy ways, a little more technical ways to do it. I'm going to show you what I do on tracks that I'm not going to play that often, but I like, and I want to be able to, you know, set them up so I could drop it into a dance mix and be cool. Okay, here's what I'll do. I look for a part in the song that has a repeating pattern, and then I set that up as a hot cue loop, okay? And I can use that in my mixing. So let me show you what that means. Now this one, I already strategized a little bit, and I figured out that this first part, okay, that first bar, that's perfect for me, okay? Well, it's near perfect. I'll show you what I mean. So here's how this goes. I want to set this up as a loop hot cue. All I have to do is set up a 4-bar loop, and my Pioneer controller has a 4-beat loop on and off right here, a little button. I click that. You could also click this guy right here. Boom. 4-beat loop. And what does that do? That sets up a 4-beat loop. That's it. I have now a 4-beat loop that is my intro. But can you hear? There's like the little bit of Pitbull saying Mr. Worldwide, and he's doing mit, mit. Sounds like he's heaving there. I don't want that part. I don't want that part. So here's what I gotta do. I could live with it. I definitely could live with it. And all I would need to do is I would take off my hot cue that I have in A, okay? Take off that hot cue. And whenever Rekordbox, whenever you have a loop set and you hit a hot cue button, it sets a hot cue loop. Look at that. It made it orange instead of red, and it made a little loop symbol. So no matter where I am in the song, I'm gonna fast forward to the forward in the song, and I'm just gonna push play. So I'm just in the song, but if I hit this cue, which is A, watch what happens. Right to the loop, and it loops. I didn't hit the loop entrance, or, you know, I didn't hit the loop on or anything like that. It just jumps into the loop. And then to get out of the loop, you can either hit the loop exit button, like that, or you can hit another hot cue, which we will. But back to my little problem, because, you know, again, I don't want to let perfect be the enemy of great, but I do want it to sound really nice. So let's go for a great solution. That's not perfect, but it's great. And what that involves is I'm going to look at this and I'm going to say, you know, this, here's him saying, Mr. right here. It's this part right here. It's this little part right here. That little orange is him saying Mr. Right before the loop ends and we drop back to beat 1.1. It's at the end of beat 1.4. So I'm gonna cut that part out. But I need to maintain the order and balance in the universe, and I need to have 4 beats. So what I can do, and this is, again, this is a little bit, you wouldn't have to do this. You could just live with the huh, okay? It's fine. Might even sound kind of cool, I don't know. But here's what I'm gonna do to get rid of that. I'm gonna take us off of quantize mode. So that basically you're taking out your safety net. You're not snapping to the grid anymore. And I'm gonna move this. And basically what I wanna do is I want the loop to end right here, okay? before he says, Mr. Okay? So how I do this is I'm going to use my beat jump and I'm going to go back four beats. One, two, oh, I went back all four at once. Okay, so I'm going to use this part right here. One, two, three, four. And look at that. I'm actually starting a little bit before the start of the song, okay, where my prior cue point was set. And here's what I'm going to do next. I'm going to eliminate my cue point. I'm going to hit my loop button. And look at that. It set a loop starting at, since quantize was off, it set a loop right at my needle marker and it went up right up to the point where I don't want it to go any further. Okay? Perfect. Set that hot cue by pushing that. Make sure to turn quantize mode back on. And then my next step would be, because I basically have two choices here, okay? You have two choices. I can leave my hot cue B right when he starts to come into the chorus, the first chorus. And I think I will do that. Or I could, of course, set my hot cue B somewhere else. I'm gonna leave it. And this is how I plan to play with this song. When I come into this song, I'm going to mix in from that loop on hot cue A. Okay? And I'm going to let this play four times. Now, there's a little bit of a, sounds like a little space. And that's that sound that happens before the bar begins. And that's on purpose, so we skip out on him saying, Mista, right? So, but if you metronome this, it's going one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, right? We got it, great. Now, let's say I got another track playing. I'm gonna start this up right on the, right, you know, in time. I'm gonna hit it. Two, three, four, and I'm gonna drop it on B. Or another option you have is this. Okay, two, three, I'm gonna exit the loop. Four, exit the loop. And you get that little bit of a. Okay. Don't mind the dancing. Okay, two options you can do. Come out of the loop when you're kind of done with four cycles of the loop. So you've kind of gone through four bars. Or you can jump right to the vocal chorus hot cue that we set, which is hot cue B. And finally, on this song, we're going to jump to the end. And the end, we're going to go ahead and set up those outro cue points like I always do. And let's hear the end of the song. Cheating a little bit, I'd listened to the song already and I kind of had these cue points set up, so I know that I want to go here and I want to go here. So the outro sounds like this. We're still on time, you can see. Boom, and we're out and we're into the next track, for example. Guys, that song is set up now. So for, you know, without further ado, let's mix these tracks and show you guys what they sound like now that we spent so much time getting them ready. So I'm going to mix She's a Bad Mamma Jamma into Jungle Love. Now, I don't want to do the copyright thing if I can help it. So what we're going to do is we're going to kind of talk over a little bit. You saw how I triggered the song on hot cue A to get it going, and now we're just letting it play. So we got that on deck one. Now, I'm gonna set up, I need to get the BPMs to be the same BPM. I'm thinking 118 is gonna sound pretty good. So basically, I've moved the track, Bad Mamma Jamma, I've moved this track up 3.5% with my fader, my tempo fader, and then I've moved Jungle Love down 1.4% to 118 basically on my tempo fader on track 2, okay, on deck 2. So they're close enough, and I would say that what I'll do is I'm gonna get a little closer to the end of the song here, and then I'll mix in this track. Now, how I do this typically is I drop the bass out of, on my EQs, I drop the bass out of the track that I'm gonna bring in, so I can kind of switch over the bass, okay, from the outgoing track to the new track during the mix, and then I just drop it, okay? So let's see how this sounds, okay? Let's fast forward a little bit. Okay, here it comes. 4 more bars, and then we're gonna drop this track. All right? Here it comes. Okay. So there we went from She's a Bad Mamma Jamma, the Jungle Love, and of course, early on before a chorus or, you know, in a verse, I'll get that BPM back up, you know? Because you don't want to change the BPM with your tempo fader while someone's, while you're in a chorus, because that's the part people know the most. So just, you know, inch it up or nudge it along back to its original BPM here, like this one's 119. Inch it up during like a verse or something that's not going to be jarring to people or like catch them off guard like a chorus might. Okay, so we just did that. And that hopefully gives you an idea of a mix of those two songs. Let's go ahead and you'll notice here my BPM ranges, Die Young and Celebrate I picked because multiple reasons, but they go well together in terms of BPM. They're pretty close. So we'll go ahead and do those two songs. And I'm gonna go from Die Young into Celebrate because what I want you guys to hear is how that whole little loop that we made works. So I got Die Young on track one, on deck one. I've got Celebrate on deck 2, and we're gonna check this out. All right, guys, I'm gonna get this, get the BPM set up. I'm just gonna bring Celebrate up a little bit, and here we go. Guys, and that is my little system for how to set some hot cues, do some mixing, and beat matching. Not a lot of complexity there, guys, and hopefully it's accessible to you if you're not a beat matcher or mixer. Hopefully those tips can show you a way that you can get into it without too much complexity. I think if you keep it simple and you don't try to have everything so perfect on your beat grid, and you just kind of feel the music, it'll be so organic that you're just hitting those hot cues as a way to trigger the technology to play the song, but you're feeling it. You're feeling the integration of the beat. So it's not a technical thing. It's more of a organic thing. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. I know it was a long video, but hopefully you got a tip or two to help improve your DJing, and I'll talk to you next time.